Hello, you're watching Proactive London. I'm joined by Tom Bailey, the head of research at HANetf. Tom, good to see you again.
Good to see you too. Thanks, Stephen.
So Tom, you're up to your latest thematic and digital assets review, and it really encapsulates the big shift we're seeing to digital assets and the energy transition, but also reflecting the current geopolitical risk globally.
Yeah, so this is our twice yearly published thematic and digital assets review. So this is the first one of this year. We're publishing a second one in the summer. And what we try and do, because obviously at HANetf, we have a broad range of often thematic-based ETFs or kind of alternative assets, is to kind of provide some of the content behind and research and really the investment case behind some of these different themes and also asset classes. So there's a wide array of different content in there. There's some kind of just some infographics showing certain investment case for certain asset classes or themes, such as midstream energy, as well as a survey we do each time of investors, and as well as a collection of kind of more in-depth articles.
Well, let's take a look at that survey. So that's the ETF and ETC survey, and it gauges the attitudes towards themes and commodities. Anything that stood out in particular in the survey for you?
Yeah, so one of the big ones, I think, if we looked at, say, the emerging markets that investors were most positive on, China came second, obviously. India came first in terms of emerging markets investors were most positive on, followed by China and then Brazil. I think it's not necessarily a massive surprise that investors will be saying China right now. India right now. I said that twice in a row, mixed the two up. But it's not a massive surprise investors will say India right now, given that it is the world's fastest growing economy, and there's lots of kind of continued positive sentiment around, say, India as an alternative investment destination, given the current geopolitical climate with China and the US, and also the strong progress that the Modi government in India has made over the past few years, both in terms of kind of economic growth and reforms to India's economy, whether it's the tax reforms several years ago, or as well the big digitization push, which is one of the kind of key aspects of the Indian investment case that we focus on at HANetf. It's our INQQ India Internet E-commerce and Emerging Market UCITS ETF. Sorry, the INQQ India Internet E-commerce ESG Screened UCITS ETF, ticker INQQ, which really it tries to provide exposure to the digital aspect of India's growth. Because as I mentioned, the Modi government has pursued this digitization of India. A lot of resources and energy going into that. And at the same time, I think if you kind of think about why you want exposure to emerging markets, one of the reasons is you want that fast consumption growth. That's often the kind of case. It's the pulling up of people into the middle class, which is happening at a rapid rate in India. And at the same time, India's youth population is the largest youth population in the world. And so what that means, kind of looking at, well, where's this consumption that's going to grow, going to come through? And increasingly, with the digitization aspect, it's going to be increasing amounts of money spent online or digital payments. And that's what the INQQ ETF tries to capture. In terms of the other survey results, we saw a strong showing of investors who felt that cryptocurrencies would continue to be in recovery in 2024, after obviously a fairly strong 2023. Your listeners will know that since the approval of the US spot Bitcoin ETFs in the US, the price has come off a bit, or maybe a little more than a bit. But we think that those developments in the US market in terms of the creation of spot price Bitcoin ETFs there is a long-term and medium-term positive sentiment around Bitcoin, which we suppose that the survey responders agree with. And at the same time, we can see continued interest in uranium. Obviously, there was a strong performer last year. So we asked investors, you know, which low carbon energy sector do they think kind of will have the most interest from an investment financial perspective this year? And the overall majority, almost 70%, said uranium again. Obviously, kind of it was a bit of a tough year for wind and solar last year, given the oversupply of some of the producers in the market, and also the at least until the Fed kind of suggests that they'll pivot the interest rates, particularly hard for high interest rates, particularly hard for their solar operators. And then also we saw that there's a lot of positive sentiment around kind of copper and these energy transition materials in the survey we asked.
Because copper is now considered a critical metal, isn't it? So that stood out well in the survey. And I suppose it does play a central role in the transition.
Yeah, so we have an article on this in the review, written by Jacob White from Sprott, who are partners on the Sprott Copper Miners ESG Screened UCITS ETF. So it provides exposure to copper miners. And really, there's a growing awareness that the energy transition that everyone's talking about, there's goals for net zero, they're not possible without increased use of copper. So whereas obviously there's been in recent years and still is a lot of kind of interest and talk around, say, lithium, manganese, nickel, cobalt, these materials that will go into batteries and other low carbon technologies, there's increasing awareness that basically decarbonization means electrification. And so that means a lot more copper is needed, both in terms of, say, the copper inside an EV. So an EV, electric vehicle, has around 2.5 times as much copper in it than a conventional car. At the same time, if you take an offshore wind, it uses 7.5 times more copper than, say, an oil and gas equivalent. But the bigger part of it really is the connectivity needed. So as I said, decarbonization means electrification. And that means obviously shifting large amounts of conventional economic activity to electric to electricity, i.e. driving, as I mentioned, with EVs, is that obviously these obviously put increased demand on the grid. And at the same time, if you look at, say, some of the low carbon renewables, particularly technology, it's not just the copper inside them. It's also the fact that if you consider where a lot of this energy is then generated, so in the North Sea, or if it's in the case of, say, China, it's solar panels all far out west, in the far west of China in a desert, which is obviously a long way away from where actually energy is used principally on the eastern seaboard, in the major industrial cities, where most people live. And so obviously grids need this expansion and upgrade, and copper is going to obviously is vital for that. So there's all sorts of stats you can cite about, you know, there should be a surge in demand for copper by about 86% by 2050 relative to 2022. So obviously this makes an investment case for copper. But as it details in the article, the secondary investment case and the one we potentially think is more interesting to investors is the miners themselves. Historically in copper bull markets, you saw it in the late 90s and 2000s with the bull market around copper with China's industrialization. It's the miners that outperform the spot price of the commodity. So the idea is, you know, with this energy transition, obviously China has industrialized and urbanized, obviously it continues to grow 5% or so, maybe lower going forward. But this new big demand for copper, potentially a new super cycle for copper and other commodities, is this energy transition, and this transition from what you can call a carbon intensive economy to a metal intensive economy, of which copper is a key part.
I mean, we highlighted in the survey that India was the most popular emerging markets, or the most positive major emerging markets over China, which brings us to geopolitical risk and maybe about why China isn't in the top spot. And we've got geopolitical risk in the Middle East at the moment as well, Russia, Ukraine. How do you hedge against the geopolitical risk? Well, that's another theme in the review.
Yeah, I mean, so there's obviously it's increasing on investors' mind in terms of this geopolitical risk, both as a kind of long background sentiment, which is just kind of there, which obviously creates increased interest in places like India from various investment perspectives, in terms of obviously lots of more FDI going into India over China with these China plus one diversification strategies around supply chains, and then also the increasing kind of importance of India in the kind of US Indo-Pacific strategy, and then also worries around obviously owning Chinese equities in this environment of increased US China tensions, and that's kind of a background risk and concern, and that kind of partially creates India as a more attractive investment destination. But one other part of this kind of geopolitically tense world is what we have seen, and what we unfortunately likely will continue to see, are these kind of big geopolitical shocks. These kind of, you know, you wake up one day and there's something very significant has happened and markets reacted negatively, whether it's such as in 2022 with the invasion of Ukraine by Russia, whether it's the start of the Hamas-Israel war in October. And now we're seeing these kind of events. They've not moved the market necessarily, but you're seeing, you know, the continued attacks on US troops in the Middle East by Iranian-sponsored groups, and what that means for, say, Iran and US going forward. And then also continued with any flashpoints coming up at any time with China and the US. And so what the risk is you see these big events come and markets drop, and it's about hedging against those big declines. And, you know, there's several ways to do this. A kind of conventional historic way to do this has often been have gold. It kind of, you get that flight to safety with gold. When these events happen, people want gold. It's a safe haven asset. It's been obviously a safe haven for a long time in financial markets. But another kind of hedge against this risk is arms manufacturers, because the reality is, we talk about a flight to safety when these big geopolitical shocks happen. There's also what you could call a flight to arms, which is on anticipation of increased defense spending, investors go and bid up the price of these defense stocks in the wake of such shocks. And so kind of that's kind of part of the article is spelling out the historic data on that as it's happened in the past, and kind of obviously suggesting how investors then could get exposure to defense stocks. And we the HANetf have a fund called the Future of Defense ETF, which is defense focused. It's not just your industrial defense stocks, it's about half that. It's also cyber defense stocks as well, because obviously partly it's this kind of increased arms manufacturer, increased demand as European armies rebuild, and increased military spending globally around the world. But at the same time, is recognizing that we want exposure to the future of defense, and increasingly that's obviously cyber, and cyber is a growing domain of interstate relations, as you can see from with the war in Ukraine. It was preceded by intense cyber attacks on Ukraine by Russia. And since 2014, with the initial invasion, Ukraine had been bombarded with these cyber attacks by Russia. Since the war, you've had states like Estonia targeted constantly with these cyber attacks. And even if you read some of the kind of geopolitical islands response to, say, how the US should respond to Iran with obviously their sponsored groups attacking US bases in the Middle East, it if you read some of these US geopolitical analysts, they're suggesting that the US carries out a major cyber attack on Iran. So obviously cyber is increasingly kind of big part of the defense domain, and that's why we wanted to make sure that this fund includes that as well.
And Tom, these themes are likely to remain relevant for well into 2024, I'm sure.
Say with the defense theme, hope not in a personal sense, obviously, because it's a dangerous world out there. Unfortunately, I think it will continue to be relevant for 2024. I think the geopolitical climate is tenser and more uncertain than it's ever been, definitely in my lifetime, and definitely in at least 2 to 3 decades. And at the same time, the theme around copper, that's a multi-year theme. Unless governments abandon all attempts to pursue net zero, there's going to be more demand for copper. And copper's already in it, will facing that kind of supply constraint. And then at the same time, India's elections this year, the economic reforms and success of India are still rolling strong ahead. India's still the world's fastest growing large economy, and the investment case, obviously there's all sorts of potential risks with all investment cases, but it seems fairly certain in terms of the basis of it, in terms of India becoming increasingly a developed economy with a growing middle class and a youth middle class population who wishes to spend their money online via native e-commerce platforms and use payment platforms, which is what that INQQ ETF provides exposure to. So we kind of see those themes as continuing to have appeal throughout 2024, for good or bad, obviously, as I mentioned, with defense being one of the questionable would we want it to be, but it seems to be the reality.
Tom, as usual, thank you very much for all your insights. Great speaking with you.
Thank you.
Tom Bailey, Head of Research at HANetf.